There we go. Fantastic.
Woo. So welcome. Before I start and before I introduce Uwe and me, I want to ask you to give a really big applause to a person who has dedicated a tremendous amount of time and passion to this conference, Isabel. Thank you. All right. How many of you are using Lucene? Cool. Very good.
Sola?
Well, there's a fair bit of Sola, my guys here. Oh, let's see. Doesn't work. There we go. So who we are, my name is Simon. I'm a co-organizer of this conference, and I'm really happy to be here and see all you people here. I also work on Lucene, Open Realms, and Connectors. Well, Connectors, I put my name on. I think I haven't even sent a single email to the list, but that happens. And I work as a freelancer. Currently, I work for a Finnish mobile company. You might have heard about it. Anyway, doesn't matter. And I'm proud to introduce Uwe the Generics Policeman. There's like no generics violation Lucene will pass this guy. Uwe, please introduce yourself.
Yeah, I'm also working as a freelancer and also for Pangea, which is a publishing network for geoscientific data. And we're doing the full text search engine there for the people finding their data sets. And I'm also a Lucene and Solar committer. And recently I got PMC member.
So what is going to happen in the next 35 minutes? is we'll give you a little overview of what's happened in the community in the last, I'd say, like 5-6 months, and what's going to happen in the next 5-6 months, what's going to be the new features in Lucene, where we're going, what happened with like backwards compatibility, a lot of things changed in there. We merged two projects into one code base. They'll sit two projects, a Sola and Lucene, two projects. But like the development is moved together really closely. We'll give you an introduction about the version. How many of you have heard about the version? None. Which version of Lucene do you use? Who uses 2.9? You haven't heard about version? You should look at your code again, I guess. Anyway. We'll also introduce you to a lot of new features regarding Unicode, and eventually we talk about the flexible indexing, which Grant already announced. In Prague, 2 weeks ago, there was another point here where we're talking about automaton queries, but today we're going to skip this because Mr. Automaton Queries here, he'll be talking right after us, and that'll be a way, way more sophisticated talk than we could like append on this. All right, let's start with, that remote control doesn't work very well, with Uwe and the merge of Lucene and Sola.
Yeah, so in the past when you were using Lucene and Sola, they're two completely separate projects. The only thing both are used were the Lucene core, so Sola was always using the latest released Lucene version. Then at some time, I think during the last year, it was always using Trunk. Then people were disappointed about that. And the problem was the APIs did not fit together. So you have to change, when you update your Trunk version of Lucene, you have to change Sola altogether. And there was also a lot of code duplication in it. So for example, Lucene has an own analyzers contribution module where you have analyzers for a lot of different languages. But Sola also did something like that. They had additional analyzers. They had special token filters for some tasks like reverting the term text and so on. So it would be better for both communities to have only one central place where you have analyzers that you can use in both Sola and Lucene. So because of that, at the beginning of this year, we decided to merge our developments. So the Lucene moved in SVN and also Solar to a common place. And both projects are now share the same trunk folder, the same branches all together. And they will also use the same version number. So the next Solar version will be Solar version 3.1. And after that, there will come Solar 4.0. And because of this merge, it's now possible to work on the same code base and share your AP declarations. You can even test the newest Lucene developments together with Solar. So because if you change something in Lucene, also the Solar tests must pass. So this is a great step forward, and yeah.
Just point it to the computer.
Ah, okay. So because of that, I already mentioned that the next Solar and Lucene version will be 3.1, but there's also a version 4.0 in coming. We have at the moment two branches. One is called branch 3X. Which will be the next stable version of Lucene. It mainly contains a lot of modifications for Unicode. Simon will talk about that after this introduction. And we started already in 3.0 to move to Java 5. But what was not changed was the usage of Unicode version 4.0, which was introduced by Java 5. So Lucene is still not able to handle supplementary characters you need for Eastern languages. So also new in Lucene 3.1 will be a Unicode 5.2 compatible extension, which is based on ICU. And it has a lot of stuff for tokenization, almost every language on the world, and normalize, for example, if you want to convert simplified Chinese to Chinese and so to the more complex ones. This version will provide full backwards compatibility because it uses the version parameter Simon will introduce to you. And so if you are currently using 3.0, you can simply switch to 3.1 without any hassle. So it will have some deprecated methods. But in the future, we will also have Lucene 4.0, which is currently in the trunk branch. This one is new. It will not be backwards compatible. And it will contain, Grant already mentioned it, a new flexible indexing where you have total control on your index. It will have revised enumeration APIs for fields, terms, docs, positions, so the whole API internal to queries changed. It will also contain binary terms, so it does not no longer store the terms as characters. It's so you can also have other encodings for your terms. And it will contain attribute serialization, which is a replacement for payloads at the moment. The index format at the moment will not be compatible to 3.1 because of some changes in flexible indexing, but there will be an index conversion tool, so older indexes can be made readable again. So if you migrate to the new 4.0 version, it will not be the same like with 2.9, where we had a lot of deprecated APIs and all the new stuff together with it, with some very sophisticated backwards compatibility layers. You may know the attribute versus token when you programmed your token streams. So this will not be available because the changes to flexible indexing are too complex to make it backwards compatible. And the API is totally strange. You have very strange names, because if you have a class name and you have need a new one, you have to think about a new class name. So we changed the API. So if you want to move, you have to upgrade your code first. And the index format, as mentioned before, changed. So you have to convert your index before. But this may change. Mike McCandless have some ideas how to make the indexes backwards compatible. But as the analyzers change, you may need re-indexing because Simon will now talk about version, and this version will be removed in 4.0.
Maybe.
So also Lucene and Sola will get new modules. So as I noted before, the whole analysis will be removed from Sola and Lucene. In Lucene, only the abstract token stream and analyzer classes will stay, and all the stuff like token filters, tokenizers, analyzers will move to a module. This is currently available in Trunk. So what you now can do is you can simply use the token filter you previously was only available in Sola and can use it. Also, package names changed, so the whole analysis API changed for that. And possibly we will have separate char files for different language groups. Also, maybe in the future we'll factor out Sola's faceting out of Sola, so also Lucene users can use faceting out of the box. So I hand over now to Simon, who talks about the strange, famous version parameter.
So what is version? We had a lot of problems in Lucene with maintaining people's backwards compatibility. Like in a lot of software situations, you have to have to maintain like code compatibility. But with Lucene, we also had to maintain compatibility on a data layer. So for instance, you want to upgrade your code from Lucene 2.4 to 2.9, and you still want to be able to read your index, right? You want to ship your new software package and use the data still sitting out there. So we really had a hard time doing that, and we had a lot of discussions how we actually going to do it, and eventually it turned out that we had a constant, or an enumeration in Java, passed to in most cases analyzer constructors, but there's even like more classes in 3.1 where taking a version constant. I asked this question because version is kind of tricky sometimes. So what could happen if you don't use the correct version when you upgrade your code? You could break your search application in certain ways. So for instance, if you upgrade from 2.4 to 3.0, something might have changed in your analyzer chain, which makes your search queries incompatible to what is actually in your index, what has been used for indexing, because you index with 2.4. So there's a little snippet from standard analyzer. Standard analyzer actually uses stop filter, which you see in here. And this is actually listed in the Java docs, but changed in between. And the version constant enables you to use or to trigger the behavior Lucene had in a previous version without changing any of your code, right? So if we, for instance, we found a bug and we want to change it in the analysis code, a lot of people relying on that bug for some reason because they index their data with it. So you have to enable people making use of a bug, right? Which is it sounds kind of strange, but in a lot of situations, it's extremely helpful for people. So what does it trigger? It actually triggers also different runtime behavior. We actually implemented, some of you have heard about that char tokenizer, which used a character-based API, but due to Java 1.5 moved to Unicode 4.0, the character API changed to integer, right? It's not a character which represents a whole code point, it's actually an integer. So we needed to decide which API you use, and if you subclass those classes, you actually need to get a appropriate error message if you're not implementing the right API. It's kind of tricky if you just want to have like drop-in compatibility. This is also what happens when you use version. There's a lot of parts where different default values are used, and as I already said, it's buggy code, but for some people it wasn't actually. So A huge benefit from using version as a constant is that for a lot of people it became easier to upgrade, right? It's like every constructor using a version constant, you just use the version constant from where the version from where you upgrade, and you just swap it in and it works, which is pretty good. In a lot of situations, you cannot afford like re-indexing your whole database. And you need to maintain your own code backwards compatibility for the latest version because you cannot upgrade the index because it was indexed with the previous version, but you can also not upgrade both at the same time. This is what helps you with that. There's one very important thing is that you shouldn't use the scene current, which has already been deprecated in the meanwhile, but it's still there. Just a heads up for that. If you are in a situation upgrading your code base, upgrading to a new version of your scene, make sure you start with using the version from where you upgrade and then go step by step and check if your application still works. How many people have you have seen this before? Come on, there's more.
Yeah,
a lot of people have seen that. So this is what happened. Actually, we did this presentation on Google Docs, and then I downloaded it to my Mac. And what happened? Do you know what happens if you download it to your Mac? There's an apple showing up there. I was like, come on. Not that many people have seen that, but this is very common. Anyway, the internet is crossing the border of having UDFA spread around for 50%, which is, in my opinion, very good. There's still some people using weird Chinese encodings. Robert knows about that. But it was actually time for Lucene to move on and have like full Unicode 4.0 support too. But it wasn't actually be possible because Lucene had still dependency supporting Java 1.4, which hadn't had any of the Unicode 4 support in it. But with moving Java 1.5 in the 3-point-something development, it was actually possible to do all that. How many of you have really changed your application since you're using Java 1.4 to use the integer-based API in characters? Maybe nobody. Well, you probably, yes. You probably don't even need to, but if you start working with languages, not that common, not like European languages, for instance, if you gonna be in a situation doing stuff with traditional Chinese, it's gonna be really important. Because in Java 1.5, the range of the width of a code point is now 32 bits and not 16 bits anymore. But due to backwards compatibility, the Sun wasn't able to change the width of a character, right? It's still 16 bits. So you could have two characters forming one actual code point. It's actually a problem in a lot of situations when you, for instance, imagine you pass a half character to a lowercase filter. What happens? Right? Nothing in the first place. So, why should you care? I mean, if you have to index stuff like Japanese, Korean, traditional Chinese, or places in Hong Kong, there's some people in here working on places. Yeah, I think so, sitting here. That's the guys from the Finnish mobile phone company, right? There's many more, but a lot of people won't be affected by this, especially people like indexing only English tags. But once you go international, this is going to be really important for you. So in Java 1.5, we have the Unicode 4 support, and it actually the character is now a UTF-16 code unit and not a code point anymore. The code point is formed by two characters in some cases. And how do you identify this? You identify it by having identifying a supplementary character which consists of a surrogate pair, right? It's a high surrogate and a low surrogate. And this tells you, hey, the next character in your character stream or your character array belongs to that character you're looking at right now. to make Lucene work correctly and all that stuff, we needed to change a lot of APIs because literally everything was written for characters. So what is this all about? Well, how many of you have heard about the language Dessert or the alphabet? That's not a language itself. It's actually English, but it's used by Mormons, and there are like 5 books on the planet or something. Robert, it's like 5 books on the planet written in this set, but it's a really good example because it's the only alphabet which has upper and lowercase characters in that range of Unicode. So a lot of people might ask, why did you fix this at all? So anybody who is using Lucene for that, the answer is yes. There are people using that. So the behavior, what happens here is with the lowercase filter, in Lucene 3.0, where we didn't fix anything like that, is that it's not getting lowercase, right? But now in Lucene 3.1, this is actually getting lowercase. The problem is it's getting even worse. There's like a lot of some tokenizers or filters or whatever, they lose whole characters, right? The Simunica character in Lucene 3.0, the tokenizers just throw it away. But in Lucene 3.0, it still remains in there. This could be important if you work like on scientific stuff where you use characters in that ranges. So the downside of all these changes is that literally almost every token filter or analyzer uses the version constant, which switches between supplementary character handling and the previous character base or Unicode handling. Kind of a tricky part was to do this all without a huge amount of code duplications, which worked out pretty well, I guess. We also had to like fix a lot of I/O code to figure out if your last character you just read in is actually a high surrogate, and if so, preserve this for the next chunk of data you read in. It's kind of tricky even on the lowest level. This is one of my favorite things: the standard tokenizer, which is actually completely rewritten. And it's actually close to be checked in, Robert, right? It's almost done. Uwe actually proposed a new name for it because this is actually what it does. I try to read it out. It's a smart EN with smart product numbers and stupid URL detection with possessive S marker tokenizer. It does a whole bunch of things, but the new one is actually based on Unicode Standard NX. And if you really want to know more about that, go to this Lucene issue. Steve Rowe and Robert are working on that, and it's going to be committed pretty soon, I guess. And that, as far as I know, that will be in Lucene 3.12, right? Yeah. Let's walk over there. When do we support 5.2? Actually, we do. Robert did a whole bunch of work on that, and we integrated. There's a part in the analysis module, which uses ICU with all kinds of things you can do with Unicode. There's a folding filter, there's normalization, there's transformations, it does segmentation. There's actually so many things it does that it didn't fit even on 10 slides. So if you really want to know about that, you should actually read this. That link is actually not working anymore. Sorry about that, because it has been moved from contrib out into modules, just realizing that. But you definitely will find it if you go to the Codebase Lucene. It does a lot of things for you, especially if you're not 100% sure what kind of language you're indexing. It gives you a really good default. One of the nice features about that is the ICU tokenizer. It actually finds boundaries between characters without necessarily looking at white spaces, as traditional approaches do. So if you're running like in problems indexing Thai or Lao or something like that, you probably are off to use the ICU tokenizer. So to give you a little overview, these are all transliterations of the QuickBrown Fox.
And this is up there is the input. That is the output of the ICU tokenized and ICU folding filter. And it does a lot of stuff for you, like all the diacritics removal. However, if it's composed characters or not, it does actually segmentation here. You see the Thai stuff here. So it's actually giving you a really good default for what almost whatever you want to do. There will definitely be certain cases, like the German umlaut, sometimes needs to be expanded to UE. This is stuff you need to do by hand, but if you're not aware of what you're actually indexing, this is actually a very, very, very good default. Yeah, I hand over to Uwe, and he's going to finish the presentation. Thanks.
Yeah. So the next stuff is not available with Lucene 3.1. This is all new stuff. It's currently under heavy development. So it will be only available after Lucene 4.0. As I noted before, a lot of APIs will change. So if you have written own queries, you have to change them to use the new APIs. So flexible indexing is mainly used for customizing how your index is represented on disk. So what you can do is, for example, if you have a special format for your posting lists where the term to doc mapping is in, and maybe there's a new invention about how to store this very intelligent on disk, you can write a codec that does this. This codec will simply implement all these interfaces you need for the indexer to index the code, and also for the index reader to enumerate tokens, posting list, and so on. At the moment, it is under heavy development, so the API may change suddenly. So don't rely on that code. So as I noted before, it changes a lot of existing classes. One of the biggest changes is you may know that Lucene in the past had mixed together the fields and the terms. So each term in the index was the pair of field name and token. This changed now, and we have a four-dimensional enumeration API. This is because in flexible indexing, you can configure for each field name a different index codec. So you can, for example, your primary fields in your index, which contains unique identifiers to your database, in a special posting format that is more effective for that. Because of that, we have an enumeration of the fields. From the fields, you get to the terms of each field. And when you have the terms, you can get the documents and the positions of this term occurrence. So what also changed is you may have seen... Was it... Yeah, you may have seen when you wrote own queries iterating over the term enumeration, you see a lot of strange code. And when you look through the internet and you see some code examples from somebody dealing with term enumeration, it's mostly incomplete because it's missing the first term or something like that, because the seeking is written wrong. So what changed is now all these enumerations are working like standard Java iterators, so you can work with them with simple while loops as you did before. But what also is included is every enumeration contains a seek call. This is important for the stuff Robert will talk about later. And so additionally, we changed all terms from being character arrays to simple byte arrays containing UTF-8 text. With that, it may be possible, for example, if you are indexing Far Eastern text, to use another encoding to encode your terms, because if you have Japanese text, one character may need 3 bytes of text, 3 bytes in UTF-8, so you can use another encoding, which the ICU library gives you. Also, since 2.9, we have this new numeric fields, and what are the numeric fields which are encoded at the moment in as something like ASCII characters? These numeric terms can now be stored directly as numerics, so you can simply store the 4 bytes of the float inside the numeric terms. And so to make use of this new byte arrays, the indexer uses shared bytes ref classes, which is a little bit similar to the Java new IO byte buffer, so you can wrap it around a byte and you have an offset, and then, for example, if you read the posting list, you get back a byte ref that is positioned at the position in your index file, which contains the actual bytes you need, or, for example, the same for the term. So what's also new is, since 2.9, we have in all the token streams, you have these attributes. You may know term attribute, position increment attribute, offset attribute, and you also have custom attributes like the payload attribute at the moment, which can be used to add special information about your term occurrence in the posting list. But the problem with the payloads is that it's simply a byte array and you are not type safe. So if you have an index created with some code that encodes your boost factors of the terms simply as a byte array and you upgrade your software later, you cannot read it again, for example, if the encoding changes. So you can, it saves inside the index what the encoding is, which attribute was used. So you could, for example, add a boost attribute to your terms and then boost them up in the queries. So this replaces the payload. This is not yet implemented at the moment, but will come soon when Michael Busch has some time to do it. So what will be added to the attribute source API is serialization of attributes. So the boost attribute would contain some code to write and read the boost factor to the index. It at one place, something like a boost attribute is used for the term enumeration used in the fuzzy query Robert will talk later about. So this is a comparison how preflex and flex term enumeration looks like. Okay, the code on the left side is a little bit shorter, but you see here on the right side, it uses the attributes. So what you see here is on the left side, the strange do while clause. On the right side, you see a standard iterator that enumerates the terms. So how do I extend flex with codec? A codec represents the primary extension point of the index writer and index reader. So you can pass it to segments reader to decode the index format. So in your constructor of index reader, there's since 3.1 index reader config and index writer config where you can configure all this stuff. And it's simply the reader and writer for the posting files. So at the moment, there are some pre-built codecs inside. At the moment, we have the preflex codec, but this is only used to read old indexes. And as I noted before, we will drop backwards compatibility for the indexes. So the index conversion tool will use this codec to copy the segments from the old index to the new one. The reason behind this, the preflex codec is not working correctly anymore because we changed all terms from characters to bytes ref, and when you have the supplementary characters and so on, the order of your terms changes a little bit, and because of that, the term enumeration behaves a little bit different after that, and so the index format in the old index is no longer correct, so during the conversion, the whole term dictionary to be reordered. This is why we have to drop index compatibility. The new standard index codec is mostly the same like the preflex codec, but it uses is more memory efficient because of the reused bytesref classes and so on. So it's also faster for seeking in the term index, which is needed for the automaton queries. And yeah, so there is currently a patch for additional codec, which is P4 delta codec. I don't want to talk about that as I not really know how it works, but secondary codec, it's a pulsing codec, which is very interesting. If you have, for example, in your index a primary field key, that only each term has only one document that is attached to it, so it's for low frequency terms. The idea is to remove the postings from the frequency file and directly store it in the term dictionary. So you don't need to first look up the term and then seek inside the frequency file to find the correct documents. So this is just a wrapper codec around another codec that simply delegates for low frequency terms to write everything into the link. Here's a speed comparison. It was posted, I think, yesterday by Mike McCandles, who did most of the stuff in the flexible indexing recently. So if you have a primary key field and you cleaned up your caches in and started to have lookup term documents for this primary field key, you see the CS speed above 40%, and later if you do a lot of random term lookups, it goes down and a little bit, but it's still faster because you don't have to maintain two files, you just have to look up the correct document. So in this will be also available in Zola at the moment. In your field configuration, it will be possible to also specify the codec used for the field in your schema. So the current state of Flex is, at the moment with standard codec, all tests pass, and also all Lucy, also all Zola tests. So it's currently used with the trunk version of Zola, and it's stable. The codecs are not yet all tested thoroughly, so we have some test cases that change the codec and do the same test case again for different codecs. But there's a lot of to do at the moment. So in the future, we will have the serialization of the custom attributes that are replacements for the payload attribute. It will have more RAM savings. The index compression will be improved. For example, the pulsing codec, when you use a pulsing codec for such a primary key field, your index size also drops. In this test index, it was about 10% less space needed for this field. Also, in planning is a faster near real-time performance. Michael Busch will talk about that in the afternoon. And at the moment, there's a lot of work to do to convert all queries to use only byte terms and no longer the character-based terms. So it's then possible to create a term query using this byte array if you want to search for this special encoded Chinese characters or something like that. So what we need is a lot of help, and we need you to simply check out the current trunk, Lucene Zola, and play with it. You just install it and convert your all indexes or re-index and tell us how it works for you, if it gets faster or if you find some performance problems somewhere. So just try it out and open Jira issues telling us what you think about. And also try out the API and look after converting your code and if it is simpler for you and so on. So we still need your work and help. So it would be nice if you give us some feedback about it. Lucene 3.1 will be released, I think, this summer, but the 4.0, it will take some longer time, though. I cannot give any date. So, any questions? I think that should be possible, yeah.
I don't know that much about HBase, yeah. But I could imagine how you want to do it, and I could work with Codex pretty well. What's that? Oh, sorry, I'm not on the video. Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be great. There any more questions before I run around with the microphone? Thanks.
No questions anymore. Then,
okay. Thank you.
So now.